Okay, right. Why science is better than religion, it always has been. I'll be proposing two shocking ideas today. Ideas that make people angry, or happy, depending. The first idea is that scientific values have been in conflict with religion for thousands of years. So have the findings of science. Yet religion always loses any fair argument between them. Only science has been proven right time and again. So much so that to any reasonable person informed of the facts, so we believe, the debate is over. Religion lost. So the only way anyone, and that means anyone here, the only way you can remain religious in this modern world is if you remain ignorant of the facts or make a virtue of being unreasonable. That may sound harsh, but it's the way I see it. The second shocking thing I'll argue today is that all this is true even in the area of morality. The only true moral facts, the only true moral values that we can ever claim to know are the moral facts and values discoverable by science. Now, don't worry, I can hear some of you squirming in your seats already. Your bullshit detectors are probably pegging out, I know. I know these are bold statements. I know I have a pretty big burden to meet. I can't meet it all in this one talk, but I'll give you an outline. And of course, in my book, I bear most of the burden there. But the case is so solid, so clear, that if you don't already agree with me from the start, some people here already do, by the time I'm done, if you've read my book especially, you'll have a hard time coming up with any valid reason not to agree with me. I predict that will annoy you. Sorry. Okay, my first bold statement. Religion has always been in conflict with scientific values, and science should be recognized as the winner of this conflict. By any fair assessment, it is. But I should explain what I mean here, because by science and by religion, I mean particular things. Words can mean all sorts of different things in different contexts, and these words are no exception. By religion, I mean any system of beliefs and values based in some way or other on unscientific thinking, depending on some source of knowledge other than scientific reason. Now, even I have used the word religion in a different sense before. Religion can also mean a sincere devotion to any worldview, any philosophy of life, as a source of meaning and values. That's a valid use of the word, and in that sense, I myself am a deeply religious man. But that's not the kind of religion I'm talking about today. Here I mean religion in the narrower sense, devotion to a worldview not built on science. On the other hand, by science, I mean the whole system of values and ideas on which scientific thinking is based. I'm not defending what I call half-assed science. I'm defending the fully scientific life. Religion provides an analogy. We all know people who claim to be religious, but they'll really just compartmentalize their religion. They'll lie, cheat, or steal. They'll support wars and exploit the poor. They'll be mean to people or worship money, then go to church and make impassioned speeches about God and faith in the Bible. I'm sure every Christian here would agree you would not want Christianity to be judged by the standards set by hypocrites such as those. If you sincerely ask yourself, what would Jesus do? Your answer can't honestly be supporting a war in Iraq or denying charitable health care to the poor. If there is anything Jesus was ever at all clear about, it was an absolute rejection of all violence whatsoever and a total devotion to the welfare of the poor. If you can imagine Jesus bombing Iraqi villages and telling the poor they don't deserve medical care because the rich deserve their money, you clearly aren't reading the Bible with any pious care. Certainly, according to the Bible, gleefully supporting wars and neglecting the poor is a very unreligious thing to do, yet it seems to be those who are the most religious who tend to do it. Now that's compartmentalizing. They are only true to their religion when and where it suits them. They ignore it in every other part of their life. If you want to play up how great Christians are, you don't point to these people. You point to those you think truly live up to Christian values in every single area of their life. It works the same way for scientists. Many scientists, perhaps even most, just like Christians, don't really live the fully scientific life. They compartmentalize too. They do science faithfully in the lab, but neglect to follow the scientific method in their private lives. They use science to get what they want, but don't scientifically examine whether they should even want those things. So just as Christians have the shame of a Torquemada, a religious compartmentalist if ever there was one, or even Hitler, another devoted Christian, despite the lies he may have been told about him, he was a believer, so modern scientists have the shame of a Mengele, the barbaric Nazi experimenter on live Jewish subjects, or the equally patriotic scientists who ran the Tuskegee syphilis study for the United States government, another appallingly immoral abuse of science. By not living the fully scientific life, these men never scientifically examined if what they were doing was even what they should be doing. I don't want to compare the half-assed scientist with the half-assed believer. I want to compare the fully religious life with the fully scientific life. It's these that must be tested against each other so we can know which we should aspire to. Now, if we use the term religion in its broader sense, the sense of a sincere devotion to any worldview, then science and religion are compatible. We can have such a thing as a scientific religion. I'll even give you a real example of that in a little bit. But it will be my contention today that scientific religion now will always lead to godless naturalism, which means secular humanism. Scientifically, I argue, this is the only true religion. Only non-scientific religion can lead anywhere else. And that's why I'll be using the word religion today in the narrower sense, in the sense of a non-scientific religion, in contrast with the fully scientific life. Now, what's the difference? Scientific religion embraces scientific values and scientific methods and obeys the dictates of logic and reason, and as a result, it changes with the evidence. It conforms to the evidence. It gives the evidence supreme authority over all other authorities. Non-scientific religion, however, does not change with the evidence. It opposes or demotes the fundamental values of science and defends its core dogmas, often even against the evidence. And when it does change, it does so unscientifically, not following any application of scientific methods. Yeah, okay, but what are these scientific methods and values I keep going on about? Everyone here should know what I mean by logic and reason. I don't think any people here, hopefully, believe it's okay to hold illogical or irrational or unreasonable beliefs. Even non-scientific religion can promote that view. What makes a non-scientific religion is not a rejection or demotion of logic and reason, but a rejection or demotion of scientific values and methods. So, what are scientific values? There are three fundamental values upon which all science depends. Without them, there is no true scientific thought. Suppress them, and you suppress scientific thought. Abandon them, and you abandon scientific thought. What are those three values? Quite simply, curiosity, empiricism, and progress. Scientific thought requires us to view curiosity, first of all, and the pursuit of curiosity as a moral good. To embrace this value means valuing curiosity, rewarding it, encouraging it, enjoying it, living it in every area of our lives. Now, ancient Christianity, in its first 300 years, condemned curiosity as a dangerous sin. Christian fathers like Tertullian, Lactantius, Eusebius all denounced curiosity as either useless or an actual evil, arguing that any secrets God did not already tell us, he obviously didn't want us to know. So pursuing curiosity was to act against God's will. Now, even Christians who didn't take so harsh a stand as that still regarded curiosity with ambivalence, as a manifestation of human vanity, or as a distraction from the only acceptable curiosity, the curiosity to know God's word. In contrast, Roman philosophers defended scientific curiosity in lofty terms, as one of man's greatest virtues, essential to his ever knowing the truth about anything, including God and morality. Now, scientific thought also requires us to view empiricism as a moral good. Empiricism is the belief that all knowledge arises from experience, and therefore all claims to knowledge must be tested against experience. The only way to learn whether a claim is true or false is by that method. Observation, experimentation, public demonstration will then carry the highest authority in all disputes of fact. To embrace this means valuing empiricism as the only reliable way to know anything. It means rewarding those who pursue knowledge empirically and encouraging empirical thought, enjoying empirical pursuits, living an empirical life. Now, the ancient Christians also condemned empiricism as contrary to God, or as hardly more than a useless display of human arrogance. Many argued that nothing could be known empirically, and even if it could, such knowledge had no value. Apart from basic practical skills and common lore and everyday knowledge, Only revelation, holy scripture, and faith-based intuition had any value as sources of knowledge. The word of God, and those chosen by God to interpret it, held instead the highest authority. The notion that the evidence held highest authority and could refute even the Bible was thus denounced as tantamount to rejecting the authority of God, which of course was fundamentally wicked. In contrast, again, Roman philosophers, right along time, the same time as the Christians, defended empiricism as one of man's greatest discoveries, essential to his ever knowing the truth about anything, including God and morality. Now, thirdly, scientific thought requires a belief that progress and the pursuit of progress is a moral good. To embrace this means valuing humanity's progress in knowledge in every field, rewarding this progress, encouraging it, and praising it as possible, useful, and good. And yes, the ancient Christians condemned this too. Not only did many early Christian intellectuals declare progress in knowledge impossible, and thus its pursuit vain, many also declared it useless or even dangerous, even if it could be achieved. Individuals can progress in their understanding of God's word, but the very notion of learning new things about God or God's creation, or correcting our dogmas about them, was regarded with suspicion as a possible path to heresy. Even if you could avoid this danger, the knowledge thus gained was thought to have only little use, since the gospel was all anyone needed to be saved, and being saved is all anyone really needed. Thus, while some regarded valuing progress sinful, others regarded it as of little worth, and either way, the value of it was abandoned. In contrast, again, Roman philosophers defended progress in knowledge as one of the greatest gifts an individual could bestow on future generations, essential to our discovering and perfecting any true knowledge about anything, including, again, God and morality. So the debate over whether our religion should be scientific or not began in ancient Greece and Rome. On the side of science were the philosophers, who believed we could know nothing about God or moral truth unless we could prove it from evidence and reason. They rejected sacred tradition, revelation, and pious intuition as unreliable sources of knowledge. Against the philosophers were the people of faith, like the Christians, who believed we could know nothing about God or moral truth unless we received special communications from God himself, in visions or dreams or holy inspiration, or learned of such things from holy books, which became traditions handed down and regarded as infallible. Those were the two groups that sat against each other. Each group adamantly rejected the values and methods of the other as unreliable, as crazy, even. They both thought the other was crazy. But truly understand me here, the ancient philosophers were not atheists. Only a very few were. Though the Christians like to accuse them all of atheism, the battle between these two ideas of religion was not a battle of believers against unbelievers. In fact, the most scientific philosophers of the ancient world were very passionate believers in God. And they had every good reason to be. For back then, scientific religion did lead anyone who embraced it to a belief not only in God, but even the intelligent design of life and the universe. At the time, these were scientifically sound conclusions from the evidence. So the ancient debate between Christians and scientists was not over whether God existed or not, but what we could know about God and how we could legitimately claim to know it. It wasn't the Christians defending morality against amoral scientists. It was the scientists defending scientific morality against Christians defending unscientific morality. And the biggest difference between them was simple. The scientists asked for faith, the scientists asked for evidence, the Christians asked for faith. Ancient philosophers thus tried to build a scientific religion, using scientific facts and reasoning to discover their morality and their theology, claiming to know nothing more than they thought they could prove, and accepting that they could be wrong, and that the evidence could change their minds. So all that I've just talked about there, is what I mean by scientific values, a passionate belief in the value of curiosity, empiricism, and progress, which entail that everything must be questioned and nothing should be believed that the evidence doesn't confirm. And if the evidence changes, so must our beliefs. Now, so much for values. What do I mean by scientific methods? I'll be very brief, quite simple. I mean any reliable process of forming a hypothesis and testing that hypothesis against the evidence. Unreliable ways of doing that are not scientific, but all reliable ways are, whether they rise to the level of formal academic science or not. Roman philosophers were still at the time debating what scientific methods should be. But they had many ideas close to ours, advocating open publication of discoveries, free speech, and unhindered debate, and the importance of both deductive logic and empirical evidence in confirming or refuting hypotheses. The Christians, in contrast, did not endorse these principles, but often suppressed them. Free speech and unhindered debate were considered affronts to stability and authority, and thus the idea of heresy was born, and the tools of censorship and intimidation were valued instead. This is exactly the opposite of a scientific approach to knowledge. Empirical evidence also had little place in discovering God or God's will. Any claim about such things could never be regarded as a testable hypothesis. It had to be certain and unquestionable from its very pronouncement. Otherwise, it was a mere product of fallible human vanity. Those were the differences in values and methods between ancient scientists and ancient people of faith like the Christians. But even before the Christian era, scientific philosophers were already trying to build a scientific religion with actual scientific facts. I'll give you an example. In the 3rd century BC, the Greek anatomist Herophilus and his pupil Erasistratus hypothesized that nature must be permeated by God because nature possessed innate rational powers of creation. Yet unlike Christians or even modern creationists, who don't do any original empirical research, Herophilus' views of empiricism, and progress, even in their pursuit of creation science, and they employed scientific methods to satisfy all three values. Their fundamental questions about nature's God were how and why she made human organs the way she did. What was their purpose? How did she accomplish their construction? What principles did she exploit in designing them to work? Why did they go on working? They sought to answer questions like these by systematically dissecting corpses and conducting experiments, attempting to demonstrate mechanical explanations for the various organs and their functions, with analogies to technologies of the time like pumps and siphons and levers and billows and ovens and faucets and even ancient robotics. They sought to understand and map out the causal mechanisms that produce organs in the womb, how the fetus grows, why it grows that way rather than some other way, and also the causal mechanisms that maintain the physiological functions of organs in adulthood. For example, because of their religious curiosity, they made incredible advances in brain science, in the discovery and mapping of sensory and motor nerves, even telling the difference between the two, even in the localization of brain functions by vivisecting live animals, severing different sections of the brain, and seeing where in that brain vision is processed, where voice is controlled, where the heartbeat is regulated. They proved empirically that all thought is located in the brain and not the heart, as was commonly thought. They empirically demonstrated, for example, that the heart is controlled by nerves from the brain and not the other way around, and that all other muscles and nerves trace paths to the brain, and that everything the soul does, from think to smell, was accomplished by the brain. In every case, they answered religious questions by doing science like this. Hence, when asking the question, where is the soul? What is the soul? They didn't answer by interpreting scripture or reasoning from the armchair or drawing hasty conclusions from casual observations. They conducted detailed scientific experiments to find out, and they succeeded. This science continued in the Roman era. In the late 2nd century AD, the most famous example of a scientific creationist was Galen. In his day, some anatomists started defending the theory that animals and plants were not intelligently designed, but were the product of natural selection. Yes, they were arguing this even then. But they didn't have a robust theory like Darwin would have, and they didn't have any of Darwin's evidence. So Galen spent his career refuting them scientifically. He conducted a vast number of anatomical demonstrations and conclusions for numerous organ systems in the body that accident simply could not explain the meticulous complexity of design in human and animal bodies and the ingenuity of that design. All his findings collectively built to an undeniable case that the only credible scientific explanation for the observed facts available to him was that human organs had been intelligently designed by a universal superhuman force of exceptional genius, in other words, by God. But Galen treated this like a proper scientific theory. He didn't claim to know anything more about this God than he could prove from the evidence, and he accepted what the evidence proved. For example, he agreed any hypothesized God must explain why mutations and deformities exist and why God can't prevent or correct them, why our body is formed slowly and mechanically in the womb, and why God doesn't just cause them to form immediately at the appropriate time, or why our bodies contain so many compromises in them. For example, why we need skeletons, rather than God just willing our bodies to always hold their form and structure? Or why our bones are fragile rather than indestructible? Scientifically, these facts confirmed a theory of a limited God, since a theory of an unlimited God predicted entirely different evidence than we observe. Thus, Galen's theory was based on the evidence and didn't go beyond the evidence. It was a scientific theory of God. In fact, in all matters of religion, Galen refused to speculate further beyond what he thought he could prove, and he insisted that only the evidence could hold any authority, and he allowed that new evidence could change his conclusions. Thus, Galen's religion was scientific. Though Galen conceded he had not scientifically discovered the exact mechanism by which God acts, neither had Darwin discovered the exact mechanism by which traits were inherited and cellular operations carried out. Although we know all that now, but Darwin didn't. So Galen's theory of intelligent design was as scientifically well established as Darwin's theory of evolution would be. But, like Galen, Darwin went out empirically and collected a vast amount of empirical evidence that confirmed his own general conclusions that natural selection over very long periods of time better explained all of Galen's evidence. If Galen had been made aware of Darwin's evidence, Galen would have agreed his own theory was false, and Darwin's most likely correct. That's why you don't see any real creation scientists anymore. As even Galen would admit, in light of the evidence we've now gathered, no theory of intelligent design remains credible anymore. It can only be defended now by ignoring or denying real science or the actual facts. But my point is, Galen's religious beliefs didn't drive him away from the fundamental scientific values of curiosity, empiricism, and progress. To the contrary, he explicitly defended these values as religious values. So religion can be compatible with science. But in light of current scientific evidence, such a religion will have no God in it. Just follow the trends to see what I mean. Pick any subject. The cause of lightning. That was once thought to be God's wrath, but it turned out to be the unintelligent outcome of mindless natural forces. We used to think God must have arranged and maintained the amazingly ordered motions of the stars and planets. But we now know that's all the inevitable outcome of mindless natural forces, too. Disease. We once thought it was the mischief of supernatural demons. But now we know that tiny, unintelligent organisms are the cause, which reproduce and infect us according to mindless natural causes. In case after case, without exception, the trend has been the same. We always find that purely natural causes underlie any phenomenon. Not once has the cause of anything turned out to be really God's wrath or God's work or demonic mischief or anything supernatural at all. The collective weight of all these observations is enormous now. If we define naturalism as the view that nothing supernatural exists, and if we define supernaturalism as the view that something supernatural exists, then these are the results. Supernaturalism has been tested at least a million times and has always lost. Naturalism has been tested at least a million times and has always won. Now, a horse that runs a million races and never loses is about to run yet another race with a horse that has lost every single race it's ever won, every single one of millions of races it's won. Which horse do we bet on? The answer is obvious. Now, if we're talking about a theory of fairies, everyone here would agree with me. There wouldn't be any disagreement. Obviously, we have enough evidence now to conclude there aren't any fairies. We don't have to keep looking for them as if they could still be hiding under some rock we haven't turned over yet. No one says, well, you haven't proved that fairies didn't steal my sock that went missing the other day, so I still believe in fairies. You wouldn't accept that argument. You wouldn't accept it for fairies. You shouldn't accept it for God. Formally, the argument goes something like this. All formal scientific findings to date fail to confirm the presence of any God, even where we expected to find them. All formal scientific findings to date confirm the existence of only mindless natural causes, even where we didn't expect to find them. The formal scientific findings to date are extraordinarily numerous and include countless discoveries in every known field of knowledge. Everything that has not been explained by formal science can be examined with informal scientific reasoning, but nothing examined with informal scientific reasoning contradicts the same conclusions from formal science. So if all the expected evidence of God is found not to exist when looked for, and everything looked into is found to be explained instead by natural causes, and this has happened countless times in every area of inquiry, and neither formal nor informal scientific reasoning comes to any other conclusion, then there is no scientific reason to believe in God. But there is scientific reason to believe it, that everything is probably explained by mindless natural causes instead. Therefore, there can be no God in any scientific religion today. Unlike Galen's day, the science just doesn't support it anymore. So the only way to keep God in religion is to keep science out of it. And yet that's getting harder and harder to do, for the scientists keep winning. Look what happened in the values debate. Even most conservative Christians have started embracing curiosity, empiricism, and progress. They still resist them in many points and in various ways, but not as absolutely as their Christian forebears once did. It's clear they are now starting to concede the scientists have always been right about these values. And most liberal Christians are willing to concede this even more so. All that remains is to go all the way and fully embrace these values. Then you'll be on the path to developing a scientific religion. But when you do that, I guarantee you'll start to get worried when you see where that path is leading you. And when you see where it's going, some of you will avoid that result by doing a quick about-face and abandon the values that are leading you there. You'll go back to just allowing those things outside your religion. But the rest of you will end up atheists like me. But it's still either or. Christians must either embrace scientific religion or oppose it. If you oppose scientific religion, then you must reject scientific values and methods to some extent. And that means you must attack them or disagree with them. And that means you will forever be in conflict with them and with their results. But if you embrace scientific religion, then you must live the fully scientific life, which means believing only what you can demonstrate with scientific reasoning. Now, doing that doesn't require formal science. Just accepting as fact everything that formal science has proved, then applying scientific methods in an everyday sense to everything else. For example, suppose you think the physical constants of the universe are so finely tuned that only intelligent design could explain it. If you're thinking scientifically, then, like Galen, you must test this hypothesis against the facts, and that means actually knowing the facts. Take the example of the gravitational constant. Modern creationists claim that if this value were even slightly different, life would not exist. What they don't tell you is that this constant is actually just a unit converter. If we asked what this constant was for feet and pounds instead of meters and kilograms, the gravitational constant would be over 500 times larger. So it can differ a lot more than slightly. And even then, all it does is place feet and seconds into their proper ratio to each other. Since humans invented how long feet and seconds would be without knowing what the smallest possible units were. But now we know. If we use natural units to measure our constants, then we are using the smallest meaningful length of space and time that's physically possible in this universe. Now, when we use those as our units, scientists find the value of the gravitational constant turns out to be exactly one. In other words, the constant goes away, since multiplying anything by one is like not multiplying it by anything at all. Not only does this happen, but when you use natural units, the speed of light also turns out to be one, as does Planck's constant. Thus, the gravitational constant actually has no value. Its only function is to convert human units into natural units when measuring the force of gravity. Still, could it be any different? Could the gravitational constant have a different value? Since it equals one and thus vanishes when we measure it in natural units, and natural units follow necessarily from the value of Planck's constant, as scientists have discovered, scientists conclude the only way to change the gravitational constant would be to change Planck's constant. But since changing Planck's constant also changes the speed of light, it's impossible to have change in any of these constants without changing all the others, because they all derive from each other. And yet it's currently impossible to predict what any universe would then look like if you changed any of these constants, because we don't know how these changes would affect another key constant, this highly technical term, the fine structure constant, which measures the strength of the electric charge. If the gravitational constant, Planck's constant, and the speed of light were all different, what would the relative strength of the electric charge be? Well, we don't know. Yet the only way we could predict what sort of chemistry would exist in a universe with different constants is if we knew what the electric charge would be, and the only way we could predict whether a universe will produce life or not is if we knew what sort of chemistry it had. No one can claim to know that the physical constants are finely tuned to produce life. For all we know, a different kind of life exists in every possible universe, or every possible universe exists. So there is no genuinely scientific argument that the physical constants are finely tuned to produce life. And scientific religion cannot claim what is not scientifically known. But look at what's happened so far. In the 19th century, there were over 100 physical constants like these, including the boiling point of water. Now we've explained almost all of those constants, scientifically proving that they follow necessarily from physical facts. For example, the boiling point of water follows in part from the strength of the electric charge. Decade after decade, we've found the explanation for constant after constant. And that explanation is never fine-tuning or intelligent design. It's always an inevitable fact of natural causes. Case after case after case after case. How do you think the rest will turn out? Science isn't finding God. It's finding natural causation. So far, it has never found anything else. And as far as what's left to be explained, all evidence is pointing the same way. All right, that's my first shocking claim. When science answers religious questions, it doesn't find God, only nature. And it has done this so many times now, there's no reason to expect any of the remaining answers will come up any differently. This can only be denied by denying the evidence or rejecting scientific methods or rejecting scientific values underlying them. Therefore, the only religion that can keep God in it is a religion that conflicts with scientific findings, methods, and values. Now, in my book, Sense and Goodness Without God, I prove this holds in all areas of human knowledge, and I answer all the usual objections raised, so I'm going to leave it at that and move on. So what about my second shocking claim? Because there was that other one, if you remember. Surely only religion can tell us what's right and wrong, right? Science can tell us what the facts are, but you can't get an ought from an is, right? Actually, you can. In fact, I guarantee you do it all the time. Here's an easy one. When your engine's oil is low, you ought to change the oil in your car. Well, what if you're a scientist testing the effects of oil deprivation on your car's engine? Well, then you'd agree you ought not to change the oil in your car. Or what if you have a special new engine that never needs an oil change? And in fact, adding oil will only cause it to catch fire and explode. Then again, you'd agree you ought not to change the oil in your car. Thus, the statement, you ought to change the oil in your car, depends on two things being true. One, that you want your car to continue working, and two, that if you don't change its oil, your car will soon stop working. And of course, if nothing bad will happen if you add the oil. If either of those things is false, then the statement, you ought to change the oil in your car, is false. But if both of those things are true, then the statement, you ought to change the oil in your car, is also true. So the truth of this ought statement follows necessarily from the truth of those two facts, and thus we get an ought from an is. If it is the case that you want your car to work, and it is the case that it won't work if you don't change the oil, then you ought to change the oil. Is from ought. Science has empirically proved and disproved countless ought statements like this. All of medicine, for example, is about what you ought to do and what you ought not to do to repair an injury or cure an illness. Engineering is all about things like what you ought to do and ought not to do if you want a bridge to survive an earthquake or an astronaut to survive in space. So science gets an ought from an is all the time. No problem. Now, if we want to use science or scientific thinking to discover moral truth, what we ought to do morally, then we need to know this. Number one, what desire does morality satisfy in us? And two, what behaviors will actually produce that desired result. So what distinguishes a moral ought from any other ought? I think you'll all agree that a moral ought is what you ought to do more than anything else, since morals are supposed to supersede all other demands and commandments. That's what makes them moral. But if the moral thing to do is what we ought to do more than anything else, then the moral thing to do must be what gives us what we want more than anything else. Because only a greater desire would ever motivate us to obey. Even the Christians among you agree with this, whether you know it or not. You assume, for example, that we want to go to heaven more than anything else, or avoid hell more than anything else, or experience the loving presence of God more than anything else. And therefore, if we only realized how great these things are, we'd realize there isn't anything we want more, and so we would be good just to get these things, the things we really want most above all other things. But there's nothing scientific about that. Ancient philosophers instead sought to establish morality from natural facts and reason, inferring from the nature of man and the nature of the world what is the best way for him to live. Since those facts can be tested and logic cannot be wrong, this was a scientific morality, or an attempt at it in any case. Galen, for example, actually wrote a book on how to become a good person. In it, he argues that bad character can only be reformed or avoided by living a life of honest self-reflection and study, which requires a decent grasp of logic and a good education in the relevant arts and sciences. He argued, you have to know how the world really works and what human needs really are before you can know what's moral. But the Christian educator, Lactantius, denounced this. He said approaches like Galen's never work, but simple expressions of God's wisdom, a brief reading or two from Scripture, a little bit about heaven and hell, quickly reforms even the worst characters. Give him any moral reprobate, Lactantius says, and I quote, with a very few words of God, I will render him as gentle as a sheep. Well, that's an unscientific morality. His theory was that the gospel was all-powerful, while anything that actually requires serious thought and education is useless and ineffective. And yet science has completely refuted his theory. It doesn't work at all. Even the hardest prisons, we have to admit, are filled with devout Christians, and they have not been rendered gentle as sheep. Science has instead provided ample support for Galen's theory. People become better the more they commit to being reasonable and informed and live the self-examined life. Since most evil stems from ignorance, ignorance of the facts, ignorance about ourselves, ignorance of the real consequences of our actions. And since knowledge and self-reflection improve our understanding of ourselves and the world, Galen's theory has been proved correct. To do what's right requires understanding ourselves and the world as well as we can. Now look more closely at Lactantius' theory. Lactantius proposes scaring people with hell and coaxing them with heaven. But here's the problem. How do we know which heaven and hell exist? And who really goes there? And for what actual reason? Stated scientifically, Lactantius' theory is this. You ought to obey the Bible, because if you do, you'll go to heaven, and if you don't, you'll go to hell. But for this ought statement to be true, as we've seen, two basic facts must be true. One, obeying the Bible must actually result in your going to heaven, and not obeying the Bible must actually result in your going to hell. And number two, you must actually want to go to heaven and not to hell. But what if you actually want to go to hell? What if heaven is miserable and hell is where all the fun is? Or what if obeying the Quran is what gets you to heaven and obeying the Bible will actually get you sent to hell, as the Quran says? If any of that's the case, then Lactantius' theory is false. It's factually false. That's why Christians try so hard to invent a heaven everyone wants and a hell everyone fears, but you just make this up. You don't have any evidence that either place even exists, much less what either place is actually like, or who actually ends up there. But I ask you this. What if the only heaven and hell that actually exist are down here on earth, the heaven and hell of our own lives and of our own societies? Either way, a scientific religion will demand that you prove empirically that your heaven and hell exist, whichever one you posit, what they're actually like, and what we really want, that we really want to go to one and not the other. If you can't prove those things, then you have no valid reason to believe them. And if you have no valid reason to believe them, then you can only believe them by abandoning scientific values. Now, Lactantius's method of quoting scripture to reform people is also in conflict with science. For, I'm sorry to say, the Bible is not a reliable source of moral or scientific truth. You don't have to take my word for it. One thing people definitely want is to be free of the misery of disease, for example. Medicine is a moral good. But the Bible has no idea what actually causes disease or how to cure it. Jesus goes around thinking sins and demons cause disease, and a little magic touch of faith is all that's needed to cure them. Meanwhile, he tells his disciples not to wash their hands or even their dishes before eating, declaring, no harm will come from it. Apparently, Jesus didn't know about germs. He had no idea that's actually a darn good idea to wash your dishes and hands before eating. In fact, science has proven that washing your dishes and hands before eating is far more effective at preventing disease than shooing off demons. Jesus also says it's immoral for a divorced woman to marry again. Yet, it can even be scientifically proven. It can even be scientifically proven that a woman's happiness, as well as the welfare of her children, can be improved if she takes a better husband after getting rid of a bad one. Condemning her to loneliness and single motherhood just because her ex-hubby is a mean-ass bastard isn't good for anyone. Jesus also says that sexual fantasies are immoral. Yet again, it can be scientifically proven that suppressing sexual fantasies causes real harm to mental health and well-being, while indulging them in moderation causes no ill to anyone. The Bible also says this, and I quote, you can read along with me, "Women ought to keep quiet in public meetings. They must not be allowed to speak, but let them be subservient. So says God's law. And if they still want to learn something, let them ask their husbands at home, for it's shameful for a woman to speak in public. A woman should just keep quiet and learn in complete subjection. Do not allow a woman to teach or have any authority over a man. She should keep quiet. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived. It was the woman who was deceived and committed sin. But she'll be saved if she stays pregnant, as long as she stays faithful, loving, and pure, oh, and sober." Now, I hope no one here believes any of that is morally true. In fact, I suspect most of you would say these sexist commandments are immoral. Yet the Bible says these are the moral laws we must obey. So, either you follow the Bible and become a mean, superstitious, sexist curmudgeon, or you either conclude these are false revelations, or that they mean something other than what they say. But if you get to choose which things in the Bible are true and which false, or what anything in it means, then you're replacing Holy Scripture with human opinion and judgment. So you're still left with a conundrum. What reliable method can you use to make those decisions? Well, what better method is there than the scientific method? But if you can decide what's right and wrong with the scientific methods, you don't need the Bible. You can just go straight to the facts. The Bible doesn't even talk about some of the most important things, like democracy or democratic values, or science or scientific values. The Bible's authors didn't believe in those things and had no interest in recommending them. So how can they have known what's morally right? And what the Bible does talk about, it often gets wrong, such as the causes of disease, as we saw, or the origins of the human body and mind. And yet that stuff's important. Since knowing how our minds and bodies got the way they are allows us to understand them and thus fix them when they go wrong, or improve them, or use them better. If you want to know how to be happy, or how to cure world hunger, or how to lower rates of teen pregnancy, science and scientific thinking can tell you. Religion won't find the right answers to these questions any more than it got the right answers in medicine or physics. Ultimately, the failure of religion to get morality right is analogous to the failure of traditional medicine. Traditional medicine, where natural roots and plants are held to be better for you than real medications. But the fact is, the real meds often contain exactly the same effective chemicals as their natural sources, while lacking the other chemicals in those plants that don't affect the cure, but instead contribute to unneeded side effects. And the real meds are measured in precise doses, whereas natural sources have variable and unknown doses, and are as a result more dangerous or more inconsistent in their effect. The mistake at work here is the point I want to bring out. Proponents of traditional medicine fail to realize that if all we want is something that works, then what we ought to do is look for what works, which is held in common among all the effective agents, focusing more precisely and effectively on that, and then eliminate the superfluous chemicals that actually have no real effect on the problem, but often have unneeded or even dangerous or uncomfortable side effects. We should indeed treat religion this way. A 100 chemicals go into a root, but only one cures the disease, and it needs proper use and measure to succeed. Likewise, 1,000 ideas go into a religion, but only a few actually help people, and they need proper use and measure to succeed. Simply focusing on those few things will save you a lot of time and money and hardship, time that could be better spent on acquiring useful knowledge and enjoying the one life you actually have, and money that could be better spent on real problems or achievements, and hardship you could do without. When we see the same religious benefits, for example, claimed by a Christian being enjoyed by a Taoist or a Buddhist or a secular humanist, like the scientist who has identified that the real medicine is a particular chemical, not the whole root, we see at once that religion is like the superfluous contents of a root that only by chance contains a useful agent. So we can dispense with the rest of the root and stick with the one thing that really works, and by focusing on that and analyzing that, we can use it better, more effectively, more profitably, more safely. Hence my analogy. Advocating religion is like being a traditional medicine fanatic who says, quote unquote, only bonobo root cures headache and that anger root will actually make it worse, when in fact both roots contain an aspirin-like compound and both alleviate headache, but neither as well or as consistently or as inexpensively or as side effect free as the actual chemical by itself, well measured and competently used. This is the difference between thinking scientifically and thinking traditionally. The scientific mind analyzes, tests, examines, and compares to get rid of the harmful or unnecessary and land on the real fundamental causes of this and that. The traditionalist just repeats dogma passed on to him by others. Again, my book argues that when we extract all the effective elements from all the world's religions and hone them to completion, what we end up with is secular humanism, a passionate belief in the good of humankind, and that only secular solutions to our problems really work. But here's a taste of the underlying reasoning. Definition. Scientific facts are all facts, all the facts established by formal science and by informal scientific reasoning consistent with the findings of formal science. Scientific morality is morality based entirely on scientific facts. Foundation. Unpersuasive arguments have no effect, and what has no effect is of no use. Therefore, only persuasive arguments for what is right and wrong are of any use. Argument. Every persuasive argument for why something is right or wrong appeals to some claim to fact. Test this, try it out sometime. You'll see it. Science and scientific thinking are always the best way to discover the actual facts about anything. Therefore, scientific morality will be better than any other morality. For example, suppose you want to argue that I should be compassionate, I ought to care about other people and how my actions affect them. You can't appeal to heaven or hell or any supernatural rewards because you have no evidence any of those things exist. Any more than you have evidence that fairies will harass me or that the great flying spaghetti monster will sear my flesh with his delicious boiling sauce if I'm naughty. You can appeal, however, to how my behavior will affect me. For instance, if I'm compassionate, then I'll feel what others feel. I'll share their pain and their joy. So if I make people happy, I'll magnify my own joy because I'll be sharing theirs. Whereas if I have no empathy, I'll suffer the misery of a lonely, bitter, unsatisfying life. And this can be demonstrated scientifically. All else being equal, compassionate people are happier and more satisfied with life and are less disturbed by paranoia and anger. They also have better friendships, fewer enemies, more options, and fewer troubles. That sounds like a step toward heaven to me. In reality, all moral arguments assume that what people want more than anything else is to be happy. That's why Christians invent a hell that will make us happy and a hell that won't. A heaven that'll make us happy and a hell that won't. That's why Christians say experiencing the love of God makes them happier than they've ever been. They know what people really want more than anything else is to be happy. So they tie their morals to that desire and say, if you follow our morals, you'll be happy. But you have no scientific basis for this connection. Your claim is unscientific and often contrary to the evidence. So you can only maintain these morals by rejecting scientific facts and values. This is nowhere more clear than in moral claims about abortion or stem cell research or human sexuality, where most Christians, I'm sorry to say, get almost all the facts wrong. And yet even Christians should embrace scientific morality. Here's why. Even Christians agree that moral facts follow from what we really want most and what will really happen when we act one way rather than another. What we really want and what will really happen when we act are actual facts about human nature and the universe. Therefore, moral facts follow from the actual facts about human nature and the universe. Therefore, if science discovers the actual facts about human nature and the universe, then science will have discovered moral facts. Now, if God created everything, then God is responsible for all the facts of human nature and the universe. If God is responsible for all the facts of human nature and the universe, and God only does what he wants, then all the facts of human nature in the universe are what God wants them to be. Therefore, if science discovers moral facts by discovering the facts of human nature in the universe, then science will have discovered the moral facts God wants us to find. Therefore, if God exists, then moral science can only discover God's will. It cannot discover any morals contrary to God's will. And that's my second shocking claim. We can only discover what's morally true by discovering what we really most want from life and how we can really achieve that with our actions and choices. Once we know those things, we'll know all the moral facts we need to know. The Bible can't tell us these things. It's ignorant of the scientific facts of the universe. It's ignorant of the scientific facts of human nature. It's ignorant of how societies and economies actually work. And it fails to recommend the only reliable methods of genuine moral improvement: science, education, and self-reflection. And that's the bottom line. The problems of our world can only be solved with knowledge and self-understanding. And only science can teach us those things. Thank you.